we can probably solve most of the biggest challenges relating to sustainability using today's technology by just scaling up widely what we already have. And an example of that is heat pumps. If we look here, 70% of new buildings in Sweden are using them, 45% of new buildings in New Zealand, as you know, 30% of new buildings in Switzerland, and almost 0% in my country. It's strange. We have these technologies which are available. They have a relatively short payback period. They add capital value to the property because they reduce fuel bills. If you're burning oil in a rural area, it will reduce your fuel bill by at least 50% with a really nice payback period. You can borrow the money to cover it and so on. Here is another issue which I think is really important. If you look at this building, these buildings here, these are relatively old buildings. In the middle is an even older one. This is from Melbourne, isn't it? Yeah, sorry, I'm confused. I visit different places, but this I made from Melbourne. And so here we have this structure, which must be, what, 100, 150 years old, something, I don't know how old. Quite old, much older than the properties behind it. Here is a thought, if you're involved in commercial property, as some of you are. You know, in my country, I live in a home which is 110 years old. It was cracked, it needed underpinning, and we have put a concrete raft under it. I hope that building will still stand in 500 years now. There's no reason why it shouldn't. My family owns an old stone building, which my ancestors built in 1620. It's still going strong. And there's no reason why it shouldn't still be there in another 1,000 years. It probably will be. But here's the question. What would your attitude be if you took out a 30-year mortgage on a property which had an auto-destruct button built into it on its 29th birthday? And you knew it was designed from the outset, so the windows start to fall out after 28 years. After 29, the wiring just generally blows up. And after 30, nobody even thinks about repairing it because no one in their right mind thought that any insane idiot would still want to live inside that building or use it in 30 years' time. Welcome to commercial property, my friends. That's the reality of almost every large commercial property that's been built in Australia over the last 40 to 50 years. And some of them haven't lasted 30 years. I think it's a moral issue, because 30% of the energy, the lifetime energy of that building, is consumed in putting it up, and another 10% also pulling it down. And if we could just get that design right in the first place, so it becomes something like the Sydney Opera House that's admired. Can you imagine someone putting an auto-destruct button into the Sydney Opera House design? No way. They'd be put in prison, right, and have the key thrown away. So my own feeling is this is a big issue, and it should be part of our whole thinking about commercial property, that we should be building buildings that are beautiful, that will last, that become icons of the past and beacons for the future. Buildings that could be repurposed. Buildings that have vision built into them from the very beginning. Buildings our communities will be proud of and will enrich them as they walk around and remember and celebrate the genius of the people that put those buildings into place. And say, I was proud. I remember when that building was built. And they look past when they're 93 and they take their grandchildren there. And I'm proud to see that building still there today. So the concrete industry alone consumes an enormous amount of energy. 5 to 7% of the entire world's carbon dioxide emissions is just making concrete. That's 3.5%. And pouring it out and mixing it with water when it releases a whole load more. And yet you in Australia have done some amazing innovation with all kinds of new concretes, which save up to half of all this carbon dioxide emissions. Our people in Melbourne have been doing this, zeobond and others. And then we think about green roofs. And here's another great thing which makes me smile. This is a sugar company in the UK that decided to make power for its own factory. So they got a big gas pipe. They bought a gas turbine. They make their own power. They generate some heat from that. But they use the power and to power the machinery. They use the heat which they collect to cook the sugar. And then someone had a great idea. They thought, why don't we get a whole load of sewage pipes, big pipes, put them on the back of this big gas turbine, and collect this great jet of moist air, which is full of carbon dioxide, and pump it into somewhere useful, like a greenhouse. And they piped it 2.5 kilometers to Europe's leading greenhouse, the largest greenhouse, and one of the largest greenhouses in the world. And inside that greenhouse grow 35 million tomatoes every single year. And the moment they started connecting the two together, a miracle happened of nature. And we now see 70 million, not 35 million, 70 million tomatoes grown. So 35 million tomatoes, additional tomatoes, are being grown from carbon molecules, from the fuel being used to power a gas turbine. And I think that's cool. And it's what kind of business is British Sugar in? It moved from food manufacturer to generator to heat collection device through to farming of tomatoes. And it's an example of the kind of things you're going to see in real estate in future. All kinds of complex tie-ups where things done on a housing estate are being re-engineered to provide a benefit either to that community or to someone else. Another example of this, which is hugely important to Australia, is solar energy, for obvious reasons. You see, companies like Siemens have discovered that you can now move electricity from the northernmost part of Australia to Sydney itself with almost zero power loss. This was impossible 20 or 30 years ago. This means that in my part of the world, we could power Moscow from the Sahara Desert with thousands of mirrors, each of them computer-controlled, projecting their sunlight onto gas turbines to produce electricity, which is turned into direct current rather than alternating current, which can travel along very high voltage cables for a very long distance. We have the capacity to power the whole of Australia from an area of desert less than 10 or 15 kilometers by 100 kilometers wide. Extraordinary. Amazing. And something else amazing too. As we find cheaper ways to make power, we also start to solve one of Australia's other fundamental challenges, which is water. Because power means free water if you're close to the sea. It's just a matter of making a lot of it at very low cost. Can we do it? I think we will be able to in years to come, in decades to come. In the meantime, we're seeing the price of solar cells fall by 20% every time you double production. And that's happening every few months right now. And you will see the roofs of every house within 20 years, every new house, clothed with these kinds of things. Car parks covered with them. Hospitals, churches, synagogues, mosques, factories covered in solar cells. Why? Because they've become so cheap, it's the cheapest thing you can possibly do when you're constructing a building. So I find these things exciting, interesting, fascinating, because they offer hope for the future. And of course, they all connect with other things like water. Water management on estates will become much more sophisticated than it is today.